White, can you hear me? Yes. Good afternoon. I'm very, very impressed that although we started the lunch break a quarter of an hour later, that you're back in time. And I, since I am, if I'm correct, the first member of this alma mater here, who is moderating a panel, I would also like to welcome you very warmly on behalf of the University of Vienna. This is usually the room that we are using with capes and gowns for graduation ceremonies and these kind of things, but I'm very happy that this is now used for a very important conference, and my thanks also to the organizers for having put that together. And after having discussed in the morning policymaking or failed policymaking with global consequences, why are people forced to flee, the reasons for flight, refugee health, we are now coming to another very important topic, the erosion of international law. Who cares? And I'm very happy to introduce a highly qualified and well-known panel, and I'm starting with Kate Gilmore. She is currently the United Nations Deputy High Commissioner for Human Rights in Geneva. She comes from Australia. She started as a social worker, actually was very engaged in violence against women, became the Secretary General of the Australian section of Amnesty International, and then moved to the United Nations up to Assistant Secretary General for the United Nations Population Fund, and since 2015 at the High Commissioner's office in Geneva. She will start with giving us about 15 minutes introduction into the topic, a broad approach, as I have understood. And then we have three panelists. I start with Zedoun. Zedoun Al-Zoubi has a PhD in management, so he's a manager, and that's presently he is the CEO of the Union of Medical Care and Relief Organization in Syria, which is a big organization with about more than 1,100 people working in there, doing practical work in the medical field, in the ethical field, in various fields to do useful work within Syria. And you would also tell us a little bit from your experience. And then Vincent Bernard is the editor-in-chief of the International Review of the Red Cross, so that's the most important journal, academic journal in the field of humanitarian law. He did all kind of things after his studies in Strasbourg, London, and Geneva, but then he has 20 years of very practical experience in various operations of the ICRC, Dakar, Nairobi, Jerusalem, etc. But now he is, as chief editor, he's working as a journalist, if I may say. And Benjamin Ward, he also did government international affairs, also law at various universities, but then worked for the United Nations in Somalia in particular, for the OSCE in Bosnia, so he also became a Balkan specialist before he joined Human Rights Watch, one of the two superpowers in the non-governmental organizations world in the field of human rights, and there he deals with Europe in particular, but also the Balkans and Central Asia. Kate, may I ask you to perhaps go up here and deliver your keynote?
It is a bit weird, isn't it? I'm just going to claim the space because I'm the only woman on the panel. This is such a great honor, actually, to stand here, and an honor to be part of this wonderful panel, so distinguished and in this extraordinary setting. And thank you for exercising such great taste. We know you could have flown with other... No, sorry. We know you could have chosen other sessions, but you chose this one. And we owe you a great debt of gratitude, and added to the list of causes, the extraordinary Manfred Nowak. Sir, it's such a joy to be moderated by you. Your leadership for rights is of global stature, and for that, we're enormously privileged. Colleagues, friends, millions of people are displaced from their homes, from their communities. Hundreds of thousands are scrambling across and out of their countries over deserts and oceans at great personal risk, in flight from far deeper risks still of violence, persecution, poverty. More people on the move within and across borders than ever before. A rising toxic tide of impact from rapid depletion of natural resources, man-made climate instability, terrible twins born of consumption at a rate that this poor village planet simply cannot sustain. Impacts bringing their very worst for peoples with the very least, and on those most directly dependent, actually, on natural habitat, their lives dependent on land or ocean. More traditional livelihoods eroded faster than ever before, leading to, for the first time in human history, more people living in urban or peri-urban settings than rural communities. A rising tide of toxic hatred, hatred for the other, the fabrication of fictionalized criminalization of the other, woven from factual demographic difference and the muck of deepening inequalities. A soup of xenophobia stirred up by reckless political profiteers, the peddlers of fear, the pimps of prejudice, the pushers of the narcotics of prejudice. And yet in this era, when data, speech, and information travels at lightning speed around the globe, our world has never been so interconnected. A deepening, too, of apparently intractable intra- and interstate conflict, wars by proxy and direct intent, conflicts destroying civilian lives, homes, families, the infrastructure for justice, for health, for education, for culture, for memory, and for future, violence concentrated in the places where populations are at their youngest. Younger than they have ever been. There is in the world today the largest generation of adolescents in all of human history, and they are at their most concentrated in places of greatest poverty, least opportunity, fewest prospects for prosperity. Where resides prosperity then? Well, it resides in the largest generation of older people that the world has ever seen. The median age of Germany, 47. The median age of Niger, 15. Yes, over the course of the Millennium Development Goals, we've halved maternal mortality. We've halved infant mortality. But we have deepened inequality because we broke the rules. Because leaders of privileged communities, through their black sites, their torture cells in Bagram and Abu Ghraib, the disgrace of unfair detention in Guantanamo Bay, they allowed themselves to suggest mendaciously that somehow the rules of the game have changed. Friends, the rules have not changed. What's changed, what is eroded, is compliance with them. It is a fallacy that walls, borders, or fences can erode our obligations to international law, can erode our obligations to each other's rights. Walls within this human family, on a small distressed planet in a globalized world, home to the largest population of youngest people in all of human history, walls are untruths. There's no country on this planet at this time in this interconnected world that can rightfully stand apart, bury its head in its own interests, or absent itself from the global table of principled, lawful, rights-filled solutions. Don't be fooled. In this intertwined world, the misery suffered by millions anywhere impacts upon us all everywhere, sooner than later. There's no wall so high, no border so patrolled, no surveillance system nor unmanned drone, no enmity so heartfelt or friendship so rare that on this dormitory planet we can say there is put between us such a distance that your rights do not count with me, that my rights do not matter to you, that their rights do not register with us. No such distance exists upon this village planet, except that is as fabricated in fantasist, sinister, popularist ideologies whose destructive forces are feeding off and manufacturing desperation, despair, and disillusion. Friends, if you took an aeroplane to this Congress, you benefited from international regulations, with which the Vienna airport works every day. They helped guide your plane to a safe reception point. I'm guessing no one claimed, as you disembarked, that the sovereignty of Austria had been imperiled because internationally agreed protocols for air traffic control had been applied as you passed out of one jurisdiction into another. Those of you who are checking your emails right now, because fair enough, the current speaker is boring, you too are relying right now on an international network of universal protocols with respect to which there is yet to be a single government that denounces the use of those protocols for mobile technology because it contravenes their traditions, even though the technology is but a few decades old, or because it undermines their faith, even though this technology is so clearly secular. Which head of state who falls critically, potentially, terminally ill, denies himself or his family members similarly affected access to the benefits of top-class medical services at international standards, even if to do so means crossing a sovereign border or choosing the benefits of scientific advance over traditional alternatives? Gosh, good golly. The erosion is not of international standards, international law, or universal principles, because without them, the void. The erosion is of compliance with international standards. And the erosion is of principled leadership, a deterioration of the commitment of the powerful and the privileged and their obligation to answer to those with the least power, with the least privilege. Global leadership for global compliance with global principles. You know, I fear that those of us in power today are almost exclusively of an analog age, an age no longer with us, an age that has long passed for a world that needs digital solutions. It seems those of us in power have island mentalities that even island states know they can no longer afford. Just ask Kiribati. To borrow the words of Winston Churchill, a nation will find it very hard to look up to leaders who are keeping their ears to the ground. After all, it's called leadership, people, not followership. Of course, Western governments are bustling and shifting against the strictures and obligations of international standards as refugee and migratory movements reach pressure point pinnacles. Pushed as those governments are by the heightened anxieties of aging populations and the callous consequences of vicious criminal acts of so-called terrorist violence. Of course, certain heads of state are giving in to the temptations of the illegitimate fruits of impunity's protection when they claim that the International Criminal Court is somehow targeting countries unfairly. But in their talk of withdrawal from the Rome Statute, don't leaders seek to arm themselves with the shield of impunity? And at what cost? This willful, self-serving deprivation of their own people of the protection that only international law can provide. And yet, as the High Commissioner for Human Rights has emphasized, we safeguard our societies by standing firm on the universal principle of justice, or we can cast away the moorings of that law and turn away from the screams as impunity overwhelms men, women, and children in wave upon wave of violence. Who cares? Well, self-serving claims to national interest, exceptionalism, sovereignty can be invoked even to excuse intimate partner violence. Russian deputies, recently argued in favour of the decriminalisation of violence in the family. They had no consciousness of the tragic irony of this, it appears. One of them said, well, the real problem here is when... Surely it's unfair that a stranger can slap a child and receive only a fine, and yet a parent could slap their child and go to prison. That was the issue. Another parliamentarian seeking to ensure that they were not in any way confined by international obligations of a kind that would constrain his sovereign conjugal rights said, I don't want to have three in the bed. It's as if you would be sleeping with your wife and a human rights organisation. Leadership. Yep. International laws are swinging in the balance under these vituperous winds. The Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, the United Nations Refugee Convention, gender equality, the rights of Indigenous peoples. But it seems not universal telecommunications protocols, nor global air traffic agreements, not even FIFA's universal laws of football. And certainly not the elite's access to the best of surgeons and the most up-to-date principles of medical science. Dear friends, the only explanation that makes any sense of this otherwise incoherent relationship to international standards, to international law, are that the interests of the powerful is seeking to trump the interests of those without power. Who cares? I tell you who cares. The victims, the minorities, those without choice, those without peace, those without access to just resort, those who cannot achieve their personal goals without the protections of a fair playing field, those who need the umpire to have a fair chance of succeeding, those who do not think that they themselves are above the rule of law. Every country that joins the United Nations signs up freely and without coercion to these basic principles. They are the United Nations Charter principles. And they're further enshrined in 70 years of international legal jurisprudence. The Charter puts human rights first, ahead of peace and security, ahead of development. And human rights, well, look, their principles, they don't prevent our diversity, they protect it. They don't limit our diverse expression, they ensure it. Principles that don't restrict our access to culture or belief or opinion, they guarantee those things. And what's more, they set out the terms and conditions under which we may exercise our rights without cost to the exercise of anyone else's rights. And the opposite of these principles upheld Selfishness, bullying, bigotry, injustice, tyranny, oppression, toxic stepping stones, a perverse paving of pathways to privation, suffering, conflict, and ultimately atrocity. Contempt for the other, hatred of the foreigner, distrust for those who look or love or worship differently, aided and abetted today by clamps down on freedom of the press, stepped up surveillance in cyberspace, encroachment on public movement, closure of national border to people fleeing persecution, gagging of activists, deprivation even of life-saving services such as those essential for sexual and reproductive health and dignity. The pounding of these malicious fists grows louder and louder on the doors of our dignity, of our privacy, of our mental and physical integrity against our freedom, and they must be resisted. After all, we know only too well this toxic path. Humanity has travelled down this road before. We know where it leads. It leads to a dead end, to death-ridden ends. Small, mundane acts of everyday contempt, inflating into brutal discrimination against the other, flourishing into common garden variety intimidation, fueling persecution under whose clouds we then so casually, caustically, descend into conflict's callous catastrophe. Perhaps at this moment in time, these matters appear primarily to be about party politics. And for sure, there are certain party politicians peddling pernicious policies in a pugnacious pursuit of power. But it's not really about one politician over another. Maybe it appears to be all about one leader's personal characteristics or approach in contrast to another's. But it's not about the victor over the vanquished. Even though, for sure, there are leaders across all walks of life lavishing themselves with illegitimate license for a lecherous looting of power spoils. But really, it's not about one leader or another. Maybe it is about economic systems, the capricious, callous, cash-coveting cruelty of unaccountable capitalism. Oh, wait a minute, of communism too. Oh, so it's not a question of one economic system over another. More fundamentally, more far-reaching than one election, one government, one president, one prime minister, one referendum, or even one economic system. Today, as far as the eye can see, there is evidence that we have taken a terrible tumble into a deep struggle, a struggle to protect the hard-won mutual and reciprocated recognition that we are all born in dignity, in rights, all born equal. Friends, in this struggle, there's no north or south, there's no right or left, there's no east or west. There is only the humane and the inhumane. Our rights not to be subjected to hate, to violence or discrimination. Our rights not to be coerced or deprived of liberty or to be denied our voice. Rights, golden threads, weaving a just course from the courtroom to the bedroom, to the boardroom, to the schoolroom, to the bedroom. That is what hangs in the balance of our struggle. Fortunately, you don't have to like me to respect my rights. I don't have to be like you to uphold your rights. We don't even have to agree with each other to defend our rights. Rights are not a beauty parade, not a reward system, not some kind of nepotistic prize for good behaviour. They're not the dispensation of the powerful to the powerless. They are that which cannot be taken from us with legitimation. Rights are for the best of us, they're for the worst of us, they're for each and every one of us, to the exclusion of none of us, in the interests of all of us. And against their attack, we must stand up. Stand up. Use our rights to defend our rights. And in this, I just want to leave you with a sense of encouragement here. For though it may be a most poor and withered thing, even in the darkest cells of the cruelest prison, even in fragile settlements perched high on remote mountaintops, In the midst of sprawling, resource-depleted refugee camps, scampering along barely shoulder-wide alleyways of urban slums, heard in the calls of street walkers, the banter of market stall owners, the mutterings of farm labourers in the songs of Indigenous people, there, without a single well-intentioned, carefully measured intervention by global elites, even there you find, however sputtering or flickering, however overshadowed by coercive power of the state, still there exists everywhere people who are standing up for rights. You know, the American black rights activist singer Billie Holiday stood up when, borrowing a poet's voice, she sang out against the lynching of black Americans in the context of United States, Southern states. She sang, "Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves, blood at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees." In a world that casually betrays law, principle, that so easily flourishes xenophobia, hatred and bigotry, strange fruit is budding on populist trees. Assassinations of environmentalists, imprisonment of journalists, arbitrary detention of political dissidents, removal of activist passports, rejection at our borders of the refugee in flight, indiscriminate rounding up of people wrongly denied access to citizen rights, bullying of children for their gender identity, sexual violence against a woman just because he can. These are daily banal cruelties. They can't pass by unremarked. We cannot have these basic qualities of equality eroded. We must stand up. Yep, they hunt down the dissident. Oh, for sure, they do lock up the truth-telling journalist. They bar the law-loving lawyer. And they may again torch every book. Perhaps they'll char every page of reason. Maybe they'll turn every loving and tolerant word to ash. But surely we can know that if we stand together in and through and for rights, we are incombustible. The erosion of international human rights law. Gosh, I'll tell you, who cares?
Thanks, Kate, very much for this very broad and thoughtful introduction to our topic, the erosion of international law. And now I hand over to Zedoun for telling us more about a very specific country, a specific situation, and what does it mean, the erosion of international law there. Please.
Thanks, Professor Nowak. Thanks, panelists, and thanks, everyone, for inviting them. When I heed the invitation to, under this title, the erosion of international law, the first thing that came to my mind, anyone still believes there is something called international law? You can see that. Some students are here. International humanitarian law was written by great professors, lawmakers, but rather idealists. It's a myth. It exists, but it has two possibilities. Either unused or misused. I come from a country where we had little experience in these terms before the crisis, before 2011, because there was no civil society. The word civil society was a crime, in fact, in Syria because of dictatorship and all these things. However, we were trained by INGOs and UN agencies on international humanitarian laws. It seems that we were trained on them only to see how they are broken daily. Not to leave it to abstraction, just let me give you some small examples from what we witnessed in Syria. Before this cessation of hostility started in like a couple of weeks ago, we had an attack on a hospital or a medical facility every 17 hours. We lost 1,000 medical staff killed in hospitals. We give our staff the following instructions. If there is a jet fighter in the sky, avoid hospitals. I'm not exaggerating, ladies and gentlemen. I swear, the most dangerous place in Syria is hospital. International humanitarian law in Syria is not respected by all parties, and in particular the Syrian government and its allies, the Russian government and Iran. We have tens of thousands in detention centers. I happened to be detained once in one of them and witnessed the death of more than 80 people in front of my eyes. So don't tell me about international humanitarian law, who cares? Right now, at least 500,000 people are besieged. But who cares? Children are deprived of vaccination, education, by all parties. But who cares? A very concrete example of breaking humanitarian law is what you have witnessed in Aleppo, a couple of months ago. Our organization was in the group that had to help in the evacuation thing. There were 200,000 people besieged in Aleppo. And the negotiations that happened between the United Nations and the Russian government was on one of two options. Either these 200,000 people are massacred or forced to displace. Over 10 days, we had to displace tens of thousands of people, and we succeeded, and we celebrated because we succeeded in displacing people. But who cares? Our organization was targeted a couple of times, eight or nine times by jet fighters. I lost five colleagues when I was last time in Syria who were targeted by helicopter, by a barrel bomb, but who cares? We were asked, in respect of international humanitarian law, to deconflict and give the coordinates of our hospitals. We were scared and uncomfortable to give the coordinates for those who commit crimes and break the law, but we tried once, and the moment we gave the coordinates to one of our hospitals, it was targeted the second day and it was destroyed. But again, who cares? Three million children, Syrian children now, are not in schools. Women are under extreme violence by all parties. But who cares? I don't want to push much into pessimism, but I can't see a single example in Syria where international humanitarian law was respected. Thanks for those who care. Thanks for you. But we started to lose our faith in international humanitarian law. But who cares? Thank you.
Thank you, Zedoun, for this very difficult experience in Syria, and Syria is probably today the worst situation of the erosion of international humanitarian law. But Vincent, how is it in other countries? What would you from the ICRC say? Also, if you compare in earlier times, is there a clear erosion of international humanitarian law?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. It's difficult to speak after you, and both of you, of course. And I think the question, who cares? Well, we care, you care, and you too, you care, because through our question, we realize the huge frustration of not seeing the law being applied. But the law provides a standard from which we can measure these atrocities. And so we need to find ways to make the right people care. Because we care, but who should care? Who should be the ones taking care of the conduct of military operations? Who should be the ones taking decisions on selling weapons and to whom, and looking at the law as their criteria? So these are the ones we want to influence. And I think since this morning we've been discussing this question over and over again. We feel very much frustrated because we feel that we know about the law, that the law is a treasure we cherish, that we have passionately built over the years, and it has expanded. And at the same time, we see this gap you were talking about. It's not a question of erosion of the law, but an erosion of compliance, of respect of the law. And this is definitely the issue we need to discuss. And I think this panel is an opportunity to discuss this question. How do we bridge the gap? How do we now turn the law into reality and action? So it is not possible really to measure if there was more respect to the law in the past than today. I mean, there's been lots of discussions. What I know is that there's never been so many instruments and so many technical solutions and so many knowledge about conflict dynamics. So that's something we know. We have progressed a lot over the past decades. The law, despite slow progress, continues to develop. It continues to develop mainly through jurisprudence today, through soft law, but it continues to develop. And we have seen tremendous progress, for instance, in the use of weapons. We've seen very lively debates about future technologies and new weapons and the possibilities they bring of, in terms of accuracy, in terms of limiting the consequences of warfare. But at the same time, we still see gross violations. Certainly, we are not living through the worst period in history, and we in Europe, we should remember about our own history and about the destructions of the Second World War, the type of weapons which were used, the types of mass casualties which were involved during these conflicts. We know about all that, and the good news is that we want to react when there are violations. So we are more aware of the laws, we are more aware of the norms, and so we find it less acceptable today to see those crimes. And I think this is also a fact. There is less tolerance to certain types of violence, and we need to count on that. Another interesting fact is that people still trust the Geneva Conventions. So we ran a poll recently called People on War. We had conducted a survey in 1999 with a series of questions about the trust people have in the Geneva Conventions, in certain rules. And we see that there is still a strong support to the idea that there should be limits in times of warfare. But we see a difference. We see a difference in the poll between countries which have experienced conflicts and the six other countries which were part of the poll, the P5 countries and Switzerland. In total, 16 countries were surveyed, 10 countries which experience conflicts and those 6 countries. And there's a huge difference here when it comes to certain concepts, such, for instance, a difference when people are asked, is it fair to bomb enemies inside a city knowing that there would be civilian casualties? In countries which have experienced, or which experience conflict, you see that 75% of the people would say no. But in countries of the P5 countries and Switzerland, you see only 50% people finding it wrong to bomb urban areas knowing that there would be civilian casualties. So there is a gap somehow, but in all that, the good news is that the people who have experienced conflict, who are experienced conflict, see the relevance of the law, as you have expressed, as in a way. But we see the importance of these rules, and there is still trust on which we can capitalize. We hear also voices, not among our community of humanitarian actors, but also among the military, people who now speak openly and say, well, sorry, torture will actually raise more people against us. This is not working. This is not something which is right, but this is also not working. And we see voices which are not the usual voices of experts, but we need also to listen to these voices, the people like you who have seen the violence and the consequences of lack of respect for the law, the military people, and we need to find a way indeed to attract these people in the debates and to have them as our advocates to defend the law. So there are many reasons why we speak about the erosion for respect. The types of crimes we see, attacks against medical facilities, as you mentioned, attacks against humanitarian workers, indiscriminate attacks on civilian areas, on urban areas, and this has a direct impact on displacement. I think this was discussed this morning when we discussed about the root causes of displacement. So our position is that respect for international humanitarian law could help people stay and have a safe existence where they are. That we need to have the military forces being trained and taking care, taking the necessary precautions, especially in conflicts in urban areas, to prevent these populations to have no other choice than to leave. We should also make sure in urban settings that the infrastructures are respected and that the military take into account the impact of their actions. For instance, when they bomb an hospital, when they destroy power plants or water and sanitation facilities, people have no other choice than to leave. We need the people, the states abroad, supporting one group or another, taking IHL into account in their support. And this message also was passed this morning, I think. So these are solutions. But we need also to change our discourse. I think erosion for respect for the law is a dangerous thing, because if people lose faith in the law, somehow it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. We need people to believe in the law. So I think we also, as humanitarian actors, need to adapt our discourse. We need to come with constructive solutions. We cannot just only denounce crimes, but we need always to come with solutions. How do you train the military? What are the practical solutions? These are the questions we need to ask ourselves as well. So we need to have more informed studies, and we need to draw from other fields. We cannot limit ourselves to discussions among lawyers. We need to bring in architects. We need to bring in people specialized in education. We need to bring historians. We need to open this conversation beyond experts so that we can start talking about, you know, other types of solutions, and always have this kind of constructive attitude. So we are looking at cases of respect, and I'll conclude here, because you said, where are the cases of respect? And I think we need to study those cases of respect, because there are many cases of respect, because we have seen some improvements. And we need to study when the law is being respected, and we need to also bring the lessons from these cases. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Vincent. Then we come to you, Benjamin, coming a little bit back to Europe. Do you see the same type of international law within Europe, within the European Union, or do you see more Europe as a reaction to what's happening on the international scene?
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I want to focus actually on the other Geneva Convention, the Refugee Convention, which I think is particularly relevant for the topic of our discussion today. And I must say that I think it's impossible to deny that the Refugee Convention has been eroded very significantly by European governments in recent years. It's been eroded in a very particular way through effectively policies that are designed to avoid European states from triggering their legal obligations, so that they continue formally speaking to be in compliance with their responsibilities, while in practice are evading their responsibilities. And part of this, I think, comes from the experience of European governments in dealing with terrorism, particularly in the last decade, and especially in the approach of European governments and the US government, as Kate mentioned, in terms of the prohibition of torture and the prohibition on returning people to places where they face the risk of torture. European governments developed an approach which Professor Nowak knows very well, of seeking promises from countries with poor records of torture that the person who was sent back would not be tortured, and that therefore allowed European states to send people back to places where they faced the risk of torture while claiming that they were nevertheless respecting this responsibility not to send people to places where they faced the risk of torture. And I think that has provided some of the inspiration for the approach of European governments towards their responsibility towards refugees and under refugee law today. What we see is an effort by European governments at their external borders and beyond systematically to keep people who need international protection away from those borders, so that the European government's obligations to protect those people are never formally triggered, and they can say, we are absolutely respecting our responsibilities under international law. And this is often referred to as a policy of pushbacks. Just to give you examples from Human Rights Watch's own research, in the last few years, we've seen pushbacks of refugees at the Greek-Turkey border, the Bulgarian-Turkey border, the Macedonian-Greek border, the Croatian-Serbian border, the Hungarian-Serbian border, and also, I think, very importantly, at the Turkish-Syrian border. And these policies mean that people who are seeking international protection are unable to obtain it. Now, they differ. In some instances, it is people being beaten and forced back, prevented from crossing borders by barbed wire fences. In other instances, people are given formally access to some kind of procedure, but that procedure is empty of content, even though it may exist in form, and they find themselves very quickly sent back to the country through which they passed before. We published some research last week on the situation at the Polish-Belarus border, not a border that people are paying very much attention to at the moment in Europe, where Chechens in particular are being systematically, routinely denied access to protection in Poland, on the spurious grounds that they don't have legal visas to enter the country, and are instead being forced back to Belarus, a country that doesn't have of an effective system of protection for refugees. All of that is bad enough, but what we now are beginning to see is efforts by European governments to actually legalize these policies. Spain has had a law now for several years that allows it to summarily return people seeking protection in its North African enclaves. Hungary passed a law last year that allows it to summarily return people intercepted inside its borders to the border with Serbia. And it recently has changed the law to apply it to anyone detected anywhere inside Hungary without legal permission. And Poland is also, at the moment, considering a draft law which would have similar effect. We should also note that the European Union's deal with Turkey was designed to function in that way. In fact, the Greek appeals bodies have required a substantive consideration of people's asylum decisions, asylum claims, before they are removed to Turkey. But the way that the plan was designed was that some people could have their cases ruled inadmissible without any consideration of the merits and be sent back to Turkey. That is a pushback. The other thing which we see, which is also very worrying, and I think there's a panel this afternoon on it, is this idea of preventing people from ever being able to leave the place from which they might come and seek protection in Europe. We heard this morning about the EU-Turkey deal, which was certainly designed with that in mind. The first draft of the deal published by the European Commission actually had preventing the departure of refugees from Turkey written in the text. And of course, we see it in the context of the great keenness of European governments to intensify cooperation with Libya in the way that Italy historically cooperated with Libya under the Gaddafi regime. We see it in the myriad of efforts by the EU to negotiate mobility partnerships, as they're called, with countries as like Ukraine and Pakistan and others. And one very striking conversation I had was with a European Navy lawyer who was part of the European Union naval force that operates off the coast of Libya, who described to me his frustration at having to comply with the non-refoulement obligation in terms of people who the EU naval force rescued. Why can't we just send them back to Libya? He didn't understand why they had to comply with this. It's very clear that many European capitals are keen to try to find ways to not have to comply with that responsibility. So this is very, very important. It's when we go to Brussels and talk to European Union officials about this, it's very striking the reception that we receive when we raise concerns about abuses that take place inside the borders of member states related to the asylum system, as opposed to abuses at the external borders. When we talk about abuses inside member states in respect to the asylum system, those concerns are taken very seriously. Often the EU will launch infringement, the Commission will launch infringement proceedings, legal action against the member states. When it comes to abuses at borders, we're always told there isn't enough evidence. We've heard these concerns, but there isn't really anything that we can do to act upon this information. And it's very difficult to avoid the conclusion that is because this is a situation which suits a European government. And I am sometimes left with the impression that the ideal situation in Brussels would be to have a Rolls-Royce asylum system in Europe to which nobody has access. So what to do? I think this is a very difficult obviously the question of law, of compliance with law, of compliance with norms, is not the kind of subject which tends to get members of the public particularly excited, as exciting as it is to lawyers. We have to find ways to communicate why it matters to people that these standards are not complied with. And I think we can draw on some of the experience that we had in working on counterterrorism issues and working on the erosion of these standards in the counterterrorism context to make more practical, pragmatic arguments about why these standards of protection are actually important for everyone, as Kate was saying, and not just so people don't just see them as unrelated to them. And I think we also have to remember, we have to remember our own history. The Refugee Convention was drawn up in the ashes of Europe after the Second World War and the experience of the failure to protect refugees in Europe. You know, and it's deeply ironic that a country like Hungary, which 200,000 or 300,000 of its population fled in the 1950s and found protection elsewhere in Europe, and now it doesn't want to protect refugees. So we have to also remind Europeans of our past. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we heard two fairly bleak stories, if I may say, from different perspectives, there is an erosion of international law, and actually nobody cares apart from a few stupid lawyers. I mean, if we go back, the United Nations have been established in reaction to the deep economic crisis, the rise of fascism, World War II, the horrors of the Holocaust, with very, very clear principles. And you said before, human rights were the first one, human dignity. The second is security, peace and security. For the first time in history, war was outlawed. A huge achievement. And third, cooperation, development. So, and in these 70 years, all kind of legal frameworks have been developed, particularly in the field of human rights, but also in the field of development, in the field of environmental protection, and you name it. Does that mean, and of course the same is in Europe, with the Council of Europe, human rights, democracy and the rule of law, the three main pillars, the same in the European Union, the biggest peace project in Europe ever. Does this mean this post-World War II era is coming to an end? Because nobody cares anymore. There are more and more armed conflicts as we ever had in the time of the Cold War or after. Humanitarian law is no longer respected, not even the basic principles that you should not bomb hospitals or the ICRC convoys, etc. I'm not even speaking about human rights that are probably more seriously violated today than in any of the years during the Cold War or also afterwards. So, but if it's coming to an end, what comes afterwards? So how, I'm trying to get a little bit more positive. So what is it that we try to develop in response? Can we still rely on the institutions that we have, or do we simply have to accept that after Brexit there will be many other exits and the European Union would simply disappear? And the United Nations, as we have seen, if you go today to the United Nations, there's a kind of a terrible feeling with Trump now 40% less funds, and so this feeling, what can we still do? Are we still able to prevent armed conflicts, to prevent disasters, or are we only good still in afterwards actually cleaning up the trash? So what are the possibilities? Perhaps I may start with you, because it's very much at the core also of human rights. But is there something that we can take as a positive sign where we can build upon in order to counter this obvious erosion of international law?
Thank you very much, and I'd be keen to hear from the audience on this. But,
yes.
My deep, I sort of feel like, remember that term where I think it was Niemöller, a pastor in the time of the fascists in Germany, said first they came for the socialists, but I wasn't a socialist, so I said nothing. And then they came for the trade unionists, and I wasn't a trade unionist, and I said nothing. I honestly believe that that they have come for international humanitarian law. We can't say nothing. Then they have come for the international refugee law. We shouldn't be saying nothing. They will come, and they are coming, for international human rights law. And there is nowhere to hide. Syria is the lived example of the most excessive consequence of this abandonment of our responsibility one to the other. But power will not save us. Only people can. Slavery came to an end because people who had experience, thanks to people who had experienced slavery. We won universal suffrage primarily because of those denied suffrage. It's not the fault of those without power, but it's clearly now going to fall to those who are not invested in this status quo to resist it. And so for me, the measure of despair may well be January the 20th, but you know, that didn't come out of nowhere. That was long in the cooking. This is not an innovation. This is not a leader of great imagination and insight into our selfishness. This is a man riding the crest of a wave of a very toxic wave of desperation and despair. For me, that 20th of January measure was one sign, but the 21st of January was the key. Mm. Hundreds of thousands of people peacefully across the world saying, "Not in my name." And I think until we all understand how implicated we all are in what we heard here, and until each and every one of us has exhausted the calls on parliamentarians, and in particular if we're resident in P5 countries, then I don't think we've done enough. And now is the time. It's long overdue, frankly.
So it's time for civil society.
It is time to stand up. There's nowhere to hide. We know where you live.
Thank you. And perhaps if I may add academics as well. I think universities, we are here in a university, and in the old tradition, universities had a social responsibility. I think we don't hear enough from universities and professors to actually stand up.
Thank you.
Any other kind of ideas before we open the floor?
Well, maybe, you know, promoting the law of armed conflict is a hard sell. It has always been, because it's a law protecting the enemy. So in every conflict, there will be hatred, there will be violence, and setting the limits to violence is a very difficult exercise. At the same time, we've seen progress. We've seen progress in terms of the number of armed forces paying attention to the training of their troops. We are seeing lots of lively discussions around topics of IHL, and we've seen many states trying to abide to the law. So we need to encourage that. But we see also disasters, tragedies, areas where the law is not respected. And 150 years after the first Geneva Convention, hospitals being bombed, and gross abuse. So I think for humanitarian actors and the humanitarian community, there is a need to realize also that we need to invest in the long run and in education, and it takes time. And this is maybe something we forgot. We've been discussing a lot among ourselves about innovation and about changes and about many issues, but we have maybe somehow lost this moral high ground, maybe that Kate, you also from there could represent. And we have maybe looked at specific issues, not looking paying enough attention to education. And I think now people realized and can realize that actually respect for the law is good for reestablishment of peace. Respect for the law can, maybe it's a bit utilitarian, but yes, will prevent displacement because these people didn't want to live in the first place and didn't want their hospital to be bombed and the school to be bombed. So respect for the law is, I think, something we can still promote and we need to come with the solutions. So I think we should not give in and say, yeah, it's eroded, it's too late. No, there is still, I see IHL being still very much alive.
Thank you. Can we ask the audience any kind of comments, questions to the panel? Please, 1, 2, mm-hmm. Here in the third row.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you for your words and your presentation. Actually, if you allow me, I would have two questions. So the first one to Mr. Al-Zoubi. Do you hope that those responsible for these attacks you've been telling us, that they will be held accountable? And if so, would it make any difference to you, to the Syrian population? Mm-hmm. And the same question actually to Mrs. Gilmore. Do you think that it will happen? Will someone will be, maybe later in a few years' time, will be held accountable for these attacks on hospitals, as we've heard? So that would be question number one. And another question would be to Mr. Ward, because I found it very interesting what you said on the EU-Turkey deal and listening to what Mr. Knaus said this morning, where he was explaining us actually that we, you know, why actually the EU-Turkey deal is so good for us and especially also for the refugees. You might have forgotten that after the EU-Turkey deal, also the border with Syria was closed, and that has been one of the implications of the deal as well. And thousands of people are trapped in Syria because of this deal. But is this deal preparing the pathway for what you explained or what you mentioned, that the EU or some politicians in the EU are looking for an asylum system where no one can actually seek asylum? Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Hi. Yeah, thank you for the passionate speech. For me, it leaves a lot of frustration and some, I don't know. I mean, I think who cares? I mean, as the director of an international NGO, I mean, we care a lot. And every day we are sending 8,000 people on the field in these circumstances. I mean, I totally agree with you, Zedoun. I think it's we care a lot about this. And what I see internationally is that less and less NGOs are taking the risk to go to these areas because of the international terrorist laws, because of everything, all the administration that comes up to that. When I talk to the governments, their only concern is about setting a national there because this might bring more work, or even they're more concerned about the invoice that is not correct of the taxi of Damascus than really the international laws that are applied. So, yes, we care. I mean, and lots of people care. But I'm not sure about architects or whatever. I mean, the law is there, and the law should be used. And who is pointing the finger at the ones that are not doing it? Because at the end, we're risking all our lives, and we're sending every year people of our organization dies, kidnapped, or is murdered in cold blood. So I think it's really serious, and we are very light, and most of the governments are very light on the subject.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other? Please, there in the back, upstairs.
Yeah, I was wondering about a possible connection between an erosion of another set of principles, the humanitarian principles. So it seems that, for example, neutrality in Syria, where UNHCR is known to channel tens of millions of dollars to the Assad regime is not really fulfilled. So is there a connection between aid agencies not standing to their principles and the erosion of international
interaction?
I think he's asking, just to restate it, a connection between the erosion of humanitarian principles and UN agencies' complicity.
Okay. Shall we answer the first set of questions first?
Yeah. Have you understood the question, or shall he repeat?
No, no, I understood, yeah.
All right. We have three different questions. Would you like to start?
Yeah.
Because there were two directed to you.
Thanks for the question. Does it matter to us if we hold these people, these criminals, accountable for their acts? Yes, it does matter. However, what matters most is to stop these actions. What matters most is to stop this war in Syria, this ugly war. And if you ask me personally, I would give impunity to these criminals, although it's very painful. I lost many colleagues. If you ask me personally, give them impunity, but please stop this war. If the cost to stop this war is to give them impunity, I would go for it. What matters most is peace. And regarding your questions, gentlemen, I think there was a bit of exaggeration on that for the very same reason, which is politicizing humanitarian action in Syria in every regard. In every regard. As I said at the beginning, it's not about using humanitarian principles in Syria. It's about either unusing them or misusing them. So I think it was an exaggeration regarding this UN for political reasons from those who did that. I'm not saying the UN is doing an amazing job in Syria and it's not having its issues, many of them. But in that regard, I think there was a bit of exaggeration.
Thank you. Would you like to add on the criminal accountability?
Just on that question of criminal accountability,
Yes.
Peace must be our first priority. Of that, we have to stop the killing. Like, that has to be our absolute first priority. And we somehow have to understand more viscerally, as is being shared with us in this panel, just how horrendous it is. Something is happening in this distance between privilege and horror that is stopping us from understanding the urgency with which peace must be secured. But whilst peace is still remaining elusive at the choice of the permanent five members of the Security Council, we cannot let the promise of justice someday evaporate. And so, the Syrian Commission Human Rights Inquiry has been in place for now. It was set up for 6 months. It's now in its seventh year. And it has gathered a database of 7,000 detailed accounts of horror, 7,000 people's stories. And as we speak, there is being launched a Syrian accountability mechanism under instruction, combined instruction of the Security Council and the Human Rights Council, to enable the preparation to forensic level files to secure accountability at some point for perpetrators. The principle here, of course, is non-recurrence. But it's more important, even more importantly, should we just let the stories of people's horror pass undocumented? Shall we never recall which children, where they lived, which women, which men? We owe it to our own dignity
to document this stuff and imagine the possibility of accountability. We cannot be made complicit by how intractable are the forces that are perpetrating this horror. Is it sufficient? No. Is peace more important? Yes. But in the meantime, let's prepare for justice.
So one doesn't exclude the other. Peace first. But
peace second, peace third.
Truth.
If you can squeeze in accountability.
Accountability with conciliation.
Peace.
Ben, I mean, you have been...
Yes. You won't be surprised to know that I take a different position on the question of the EU-Turkey deal and its implementation and its intent, and not just on those questions, but on others. I think actually that the principles, the five principles that Joe has laid out this morning are fairly reasonable. I think if you apply them to the EU-Turkey deal, you don't get a very, you know, good, you don't come to a very good conclusion, in fact. But I think you're absolutely right to identify the Turkey deal as an idea, as something which is quite dangerous, and actually probably more dangerous in the context of other countries than it is in the case of Syria, sorry, in the case of Turkey. When one thinks of Libya, the work, the documentation of the torture, sexual abuse, violence, you know, whipping and imprisonment and slavery virtually of migrants in that country, makes absolutely clear that it is not a suitable place for hosting and processing refugees under any circumstances. It was not under Gaddafi, and it certainly is not today. And it is very important that is said clearly. And we must also resist, I think, this very siren idea that European governments like to put forward, that this is about saving lives. That if we can just keep people in Libya and preventing them from getting on boats, then we're saving their lives. Well, we're saving their lives, but exposing them to a nightmare of horrific abuse.
But we are coming to a special panel on Libya just afterwards in this room. May I perhaps at the end put a very provocative question to the panelists? And it's based on many discussions I have had in recent times with aid workers, whether it's people working for UNHCR, people working for ICRC, people working for MSF, or whatever, saying we have come, because of the erosion of international law, to a point where on the one hand, the UN presently is no longer functioning in preventing armed conflicts, in preventing poverty, etc. But where the United Nations actually is good is relief organizations, is humanitarian organizations. So kind of we are working in a more and more difficult environment. For instance, I've just talked to a woman who works for UNHCR in Uganda, and we heard this morning presently there's the highest number of refugees crossing every day the border from South Sudan into northern Uganda, and said we were totally overwhelmed. It's kind of, would it not perhaps be better if humanitarian organizations would actually withdraw, so that those who are responsible for all those atrocities actually realize what they are doing? Because now, the fact that we at the end are actually cleaning it up, we are providing humanitarian assistance, we are building up again what they destroyed before. So since they can rely on us, they're more ruthless. They are less feeling bound by international law. I know it's a little bit provocative, it's not a new question, but the extent of ignoring and very deliberately violating international law probably was never as bad since 1945 as it is today. can perhaps I could have a short response if you wish. Please, I start with the ICRC.
Well, we would stay. And I think also what that's the... I think we are not there to substitute to the parties. We are there to show them their responsibilities, because after all, they agreed on these rules. And these rules were initially well designed, and they were perceived as protecting themselves. And I think they were there to balance humanity and military necessity, and these are the results of compromises and realistic assessment of what was necessary in terms of violence, in terms of war. So these are their rules, and we are there to remind them their rules. So we are not substituting to them. The big challenge we face somehow is that most of this dialogue is confidential. And so it's very difficult for us to speak about violations, but it's also very difficult sometimes to speak about when the law is being respected. And so we don't have positive examples to share in the same way the ICRC does not speak out about violations. But there is dialogue, there is engagement, and we are there to remind them about their obligations. So I think it's an important role, and I think we still have a role to play.
Thank you. Good night, too.
I mean, I don't work for a humanitarian organization. Yeah. I've worked in humanitarian operations. I don't think it's an either or. I mean, I think it's a question of looking at your role in the particular set of circumstances and making a judgment about whether you are on balance doing more good than harm. I think. But what I certainly don't think we can do is the sort of we shouldn't withdraw or turn away. We need to continue to be present and to bear witness to what is happening and to try to bring a wider lens of attention to it.
Yeah. Thank you. Anybody else who would like to?
Please.
I want to just comment on one thing, which is. We should be realistic. It's not the humanitarian system that is failing in the world. It's not that the UN is doing its the right humanitarian action in all over the country. It is the international system that has defects. As long as there is someone who can veto, because this action is against his or her own the country it represents, then how can we believe that one day we will separate humanitarian action from the political sphere? There is the failure by the system of the... We have five countries, with all respect, they rule the world, and one vetoes because of something and the other doesn't. This will not take us nowhere. And again, you will see that humanitarian action is fully linked with political sphere.
Yes.
I couldn't agree more. And I would add it's not only the veto, it's the permanency of those five.
That's
all. And until we infuse the United Nations with the very principles on which it was founded, and we put it in its architecture and its procedures and its distribution of power and influence, it is doomed to work against that for which it was founded. Doug Hammarskjöld, I just looked it up, he said, you know, the UN was not created to take mankind, he should have known better, people, to heaven, but to rescue humanity from hell. And when you can't even rescue humanity from hell, you're in deep trouble. So I think we are at a really crucial moment in time where it's quite clear at, I would say, national, regional and international level, our institutions are under grave strain and may no longer be fit for the world around us. And that what we require, we have the very least of, which is courageous, visionary leadership that is prepared to be selfless, self populist leadership, leadership that would be prepared to design a system that would not advance its own interests. This is the scarcest thing that we have on this planet, and that's a terrible deficit. I personally think the greatest hope is in the fact that there are more young people alive today than ever before. I think it's time that power was handed over. Hashtag handed over. I'm telling you.
Thank you very much, all members of the panel, and also for your rich contribution. We are back in time now, so we have 15 minutes, I think, break. 30 minutes. Oh, yeah, even better. Yeah, 30 minutes break, both for here and the other panel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Kate. Thank you, Manfred. Thank you, Vincent. Thank you, Benjamin. Thank you, Zedoun. As you heard, coffee is over there. Please, we will continue at 3:30. Leave with the panel, leaving no one behind in this main chamber, and the panel regarding the new European Union-Libya deal in the small ceremonial center. Please, 3:30. Thank you very much.